Greetings, Starborn, and welcome. I'm that guy. She's that girl. This is Standswithbear.
And I'm Lightstar.
Welcome to our home.
We're here at Starseed Alliance International, so welcome back. We are going to do some question-answer sessions today from some questions that we have received on our previous videos, and we wanted to address them for those of you out there. So that's what we're going to do today.
That's right. We are watching, so keep those questions coming.
We're just going to roll right into it, and when we get to the questions, we get to them. Sometimes we'll do a little, you know, a shorter bit of them, and sometimes we'll just do this whole thing whenever we can. So let's just dive right in. We had one person that actually asked quite a bit of questions, but we felt they were important, and so we'd like to address them. And so we're just going to read the question, and then, you know, one of us will answer. We're going to go back and forth with who's answering what, just to make that a little easier. There was a bunch of skepticism out there, and so that's what we want to address with this whole line of questioning, is that there are a lot of people that are like, well, how can you prove it?
And,
you
know, unbelievers!
Kind of unbelievers!
Unbelievers!
But we understand that too, and there's no judgment on it. We just wanted to, some of the questions were very pertinent to a lot of people that might have questions on these. So the first one was, why is there never any evidence for these things beyond anecdotes? And I want to say this also relates to another question, so I'm going to kind of squeeze these two together into one question because it was kind of asking the same thing. The other one was, why do you think things like clairvoyance and telepathy have never been proven in a controlled scientific trial?
Oh, but they have.
So, well, it's true. They have been proven. Okay, there is, for one thing, there's an experiment that is called the Skull Experiments, and it's in takes place in Skull, England. It's a very small little tiny town. And this was an experiment that a group of mediums and psychics and clairvoyants came together and wanted to have a way of proving some of these things. So they did what they called in some experts in the field, a lot of experts in these fields of, you know, what is it, ghostology, mediumship, paranormal psychology, all these different things. They brought them in. I know, I just made that up.
I like that.
Ghostology. So they actually brought in these experts to sit in and in these sessions where they were receiving information. There was mediumship trying to get information from across the other side. And they wanted to bring the experts into the room so they could have, like, no monkey business going on, no funny business, and making very sure that it was in a controlled environment. Mm-hmm. And they had the experts in that were blown away. They couldn't explain, like, in there to try to unprove it, and they couldn't explain it by unproving it. And so there was a lot of these experiments that went on. It's actually a movie on Gaia TV that you can find that, but you can also find information about it on the internet. So they have, there's tons of different scientific studies that they've done on all different types of parapsychology, paranormal, psychology, psychic abilities, clairvoyant, different things. And I mean, even the government hires people that have these intuitive abilities. They wouldn't be hiring them if it wasn't real. Let's just say that. Like, this is something that's real. But sometimes we also have to realize in some level that experiences are just that. They're experiences. So it's important for you to actually have your own experiences with it and test it out yourself. Yep. You know, you can test your own psychic ability. I bet you didn't know that. But yeah. And you should be testing your own psychic abilities. Do if you get psychic information, test it out. Does it come true? Write it down. Jot down notes of when things happen. You know, some of these things you need to just experience. And we can't just sit there and have to have proof for every little thing that happens to us. It's just, there is a level of spiritual trust that you gain by just trusting what comes to you. And some of it is by testing it out, but some of it is also just having personal experiences, and that can't be proven and explained in many cases. So that's how I would answer that question. But literally go on the internet. There are so many different experiments and trials that have been proven. You know, people that have had these things written down and events that have actually happened and coincided with it.
Edgar Cayce.
And even with the skull experiments, they had people, interestingly enough, the mediums that were receiving information from the crossed over loved ones or whomever, they actually started to become a group of scientists that have crossed over that came to help them to prove mm-hmm. these things mm-hmm. to the experts around them to make sure that they were proven. So very, very fascinating. I watched the whole thing and it was really good. So hopefully that gave you a little insight into that. Yes, there is scientific proof. Some things can't be proven, you know, some things you just got to experience yourself. But yes, there are ways to prove it. And yes, there are actual evidences of that.
Can you see oxygen?
Well, I can. You, can't you, everyone?
But yet it sustains us, right?
Can't you see oxygen? Well, little particles of oxygen? Well, we're not, I do see that sometimes. So that's
we're not all light star.
I see oxygen. Anyways, okay, so we're going to go on to the second question.
So...
Yeah.
Okay, so this is an interesting question. So Star Wars is actually some kind of real, actual galactic history because Gene Roddenberry had dreams. You don't think that's a bit faulty logic? Actually, no, I don't. Let me explain something. My dear friend Alice is best friends with Gene Roddenberry's niece, and I met her in California. And when we were on the beach, I asked her about her uncle. And I said, did he ever tell you how he got these amazing stories? And she said, yes. He kept a journal by his bed. And he kept being taken out at night and have these elaborate dreams. And then the next morning, he'd wake up and he would jot it down. And it became the episode, right? Now, I want to take that even farther. Gene Roddenberry was a director. He was also, before that, he was an actor, and he did many things like that. But he did not have the technological savvy that was portrayed in his show, Where'd It Come From? The very things that were coming to him were things that were shown for not only a future world, but what's also going on out there, okay? Remember Captain Kirk's little comm that he had? Can you say flip phone, right? Same thing. And how many people went from that show and became engineers and rocket scientists and these huge schematics that they made all because of that show? There's actually a really great movie about that, about the Gene Roddenberry and all the people linked to Star Trek and how it changed their lives. So these so-called dreams, I believe, were not dreams. I believe that many of us are taken out when we sleep and we're taught by different masters, or we're doing like rescues off-world, or we're helping the homeless or the people that are drug addiction. There's a lot of things, and there's more to us than you could ever imagine. Okay, we're here in this physicality, but when we sleep, our spirit is free to roam and do things out there and create amazing things and have counsel with others that teach them things. Most of us star beings, that's where we get a lot of the knowledge that we have. You've seen us before when somebody asks a question on our videos or something and we're just like, and go, boom, and the answer is there. It's because we're tapping into that knowledge from when we did our dream time and things like that. So to answer your question, no, I don't think it's faulty reasoning whatsoever. I think it's factual. And evidence is quite clear of what transpired through the many people's lives that Gene Roddenberry and his show Star Trek touched. And it's not just Star Trek. There's all kinds of movies out there and situations where disclosure is happening, where it's training people and teaching them. What about the Matrix movies? How many of those out there resonate to that? So there's much more than meets the eye.
And just as a note, when we see the different secret space programs and the information that's coming out about that, mm-hmm. we actually see there's correlations with these different Star Trek movies about all their Star Wars, Star Trek, all mm-hmm. those movies, that we see that there's actually some proof of that. It's right. just we are not able to have this be common knowledge yet. Because the disclosure has to happen in a way that we can actually understand it, and people wouldn't even believe it anyway. So, but I think a lot of this stuff has been hidden from us, and that's why it's hard for us to prove it, okay?
And when you guys find out how much has been hidden from you, you're going to be pissed, okay? Just saying.
Yeah. So, thank you guys for that question, or thank you very much for that. I'm going to move on to, okay, can you define the terms awake when someone is awake? Ooh, many people
that's a good question.
Seem to think that they are awake based on the suggestive nature of these kinds of things. Hmm. Well, the one thing I know is that when you hear the term awakened, like a lot of people, when did you first awaken? Or, oh, well, I had my first awakening back in, you know, a certain year. And this term awakening has gotten a little bit, is used quite a bit. And people don't always exactly know what does that mean. I mean, like, aren't we awake right now? Like, I'm awake, like, standing here. What is that? What's the difference? Well, we're talking about awakening from the spiritual sense of things. And we're talking about, it's like the difference between opening your physical eyes and opening your spiritual eyes. Mm. There's a very big difference. And when you open the spiritual eyes, or when you awaken, and a lot of the starborn have these internal alarm clocks that goes off at certain times, that is meant to go off at certain times to actually wake you up. And what that means is that it wakes you up from the illusion of what you're in. And although it seems very real, and it is very real to an extent, we have to also realize that there's a lot of things about what we're seeing that we need to shift the thinking or the expansion of the perception of what is really happening mm-hmm. behind that 3D facade, what's mm-hmm. really going on. Mm-hmm. And when you spiritually awaken, you start to see what's really happening in the world, what's really being hidden from you, what's really going on a spiritual level and many other dimensions. You start to have remembrances and recall from other worlds, other universes, other dimensions. Yep. May not make a whole lot of sense in the beginning, but when you actually start to awaken, it's like a floodgate starts to open, and pieces of information, it's like the puzzle pieces, start to be able to come together into making a full puzzle, a full mosaic. So the awakening term is mostly prevalent when it comes to spiritual and spiritual awakening. We all have, I think, you know, we all have many different opportunities in our lives to awaken and to wake up from this density, this asleepness that we've been in, that we may have imposed upon ourselves, you know. Yes, there's other people imposing a lot of it upon us, but ultimately it's our job to also awaken. It's our responsibility to ourselves and to our soul.
Yep.
To actually awaken. So it's a very, very important process in spiritual development and spiritual awakening. So I'm going to use the term too. I love the term awakening because it really signifies us really coming into our own and starting to realize at the core level who we are as this at a soul, who we are as a soul at the soul level and as a soul, and start to learn our soul origins and soul gifts and who we are naturally, not who we've been taught that we are, or been shunned away. And we start to have a lot of things start to come to the surface with that. So thank you for that. That's a really good question for a lot of people that are beginning to awaken.
So wakey wakey.
Wakey wakey.
Come out of the galactic closet.
Wakey wakey. Okay, so next one. You are
Let's
right.
See what we got.
Oh, energy. Energy.
Energy. Okay, so this is a really good one. What is your definition of the word energy? That's a good question. My definition of it. I have two words for that, and that would be all things. Because energy cannot be bound. It can't be captured. It moves through space and time, all the way from the ancient Reiki masters to the Chi masters, even to the disclosure of, say, Star Wars. The Force does exist. It's all around you and always has been. It's an energy of the planet. It's the energy of Mother Earth. It's all combined universally. The one thing my star family has always conveyed to me, since I was a child, really, is that everything in life is about energy. That table that's in front of you right now, the structure, just the flat little table, has form, has substance. It's simply energy that's become form. So when we do our healings and we do our work, it's through energy. Because in energy, it's like the healing mechanism that's transferred between that is very powerful. That's when you learn to gather the energy around you. When we do our healings or anything like that, we gather the energy around us. And it's not just a chi energy, but it's the universal energy that's continuously there 24/7. You just have to learn how to gather it, how to make it a part of you, how to be an extension of that energy. It's much like when I do the healings that I do with others, and they're like, oh, that's amazing. No, what comes through me is amazing. I'm simply the conduit. So we become that conduit of energy, thus creating the healing. And it's been going on for thousands, hundreds, millions of years. So if I was to define energy, I'm not really sure you can, because it has so many faces, so many usages, so many different realities that it's very difficult to just try to put in a little cookie cutter, what is energy? Mm-hmm. Let's just say energy is. Simple as that.
And it's very true, because think about it. Our bodies are energy. The earth is energy, the energy that comes through us, the energy that we put upon things like money. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just endless how you could actually use that word, because it really does.
The energy of love.
Like everything. It's really, energy is life. But I love that energy is. So another one that you probably can't scientifically prove in terms of experiencing it, when you experience energy, you know, are you, you know, to prove that, well, it's actually an experience. It's actually a feeling within your own body. So that That's part true. Of it.
Electricity.
Yeah, great question, though.
You can't explain it. It just is.
Well, I guess scientists can explain it in some terms, but we have to leave some of this open for the unknown and the experience of things, instead of getting so mental and so analytical.
Absolutely.
About everything. And yeah, we have to prove it, and we have to, you know, see it and touch it, taste it, feel it. There's a lot of things about life that you can't see, touch, taste, or feel, but that are absolutely real. Okay.
And to try to explain it away, to scientifically put it in the little box of form and structure, to be honest, it takes away from the magic of the experience of what you were experiencing in that moment.
Yeah, so. in that regard, yes. If you're talking about energy, like solar power energy, well, that's a different thing. But,
right,
you know, we're talking, that's why I said there can be so many different definitions of energy. So, okay, so next question is, how do you know astral projection isn't just lucid dreaming?
Ooh, good.
I love this. People ask this question, I get slot with the lucid dreaming versus astral projection. The best way I can describe this is that when you are experiencing a lucid dream, you're actually your consciousness is awake or partially awake while you're in the dream, and it's in your body, in your physical body. Your consciousness is all here, you're sleeping, and you're just having this like experience of your consciousness being sort of awake while you are also in a dream state, or the construct of a dream. Now, when you are actually experiencing an astral projection or an astral traveling, your consciousness is actually completely outside of your physical body, that, mm-hmm, as you see your out-of-body experience, you're in your astral body, looking down at your physical body on the bed, but you're not feeling your head on the pillow, you're not feeling the sheets on there, because your consciousness is completely in an astral body in form. Mm-hmm. So you're actually experiencing a very different kind of experience with these two type of things. In lucid dreaming, you can actually do a lot of, let's just say, manipulating the characters in your dreams. And this is where you can actually do a lot of empowering things in your dream and actually go back in and, you know, grow yourself 10 feet tall and, you know, allow yourself to shift and change and empower yourself more. These are the kinds of things that you can actually work
basically
with.
Basically become Neo.
You become Neo. In your dream state, you can actually do a lot of things in your dreams that way that can actually help with your 3D world too. But you are awake in that state, so it's consciousness difference. Now, if you're astral traveling, it's like in that movie, Doctor Strange, okay? It's a great example of astral body and astral traveling. If you haven't seen it, go see it. It's amazing. It's a great movie. But it really shows the body, the astral body of the being coming out and actually doing all sorts of things. Hmm. Moving through walls, you know, kind of like no barriers, traveling and all sorts of different things that the astral body can do. But it is contained with a silver cord or a golden cord, white cord. Some people say silver, some people say white. But a cord that actually connects the astral body to the physical body. So you're always connected with that cord. And the only way that that cord ever gets severed is actually if you kind of, you know, pass over and you die while you're out there in astral traveling. Then you won't return back to your body. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of you have had that experience where you've kind of been sleeping and you jolted, like, you know, your body just kind of like, whoa, and you kind of woke yourself up. Yep. Well, you were in an astral situation, like your body was in an astral situation that either urgently couldn't, you know, because normally you get back into your body and you don't even know it. You know, you're not really aware of it, you don't remember it. You were out there like doing some kind of battle or some great, you know, mission on your soul star mission. And you kind of don't necessarily know you remember it, or you don't remember coming back into your body. But when you get the jolt, it's usually if you were like either falling off a cliff and you just abruptly got back into your body. It wasn't the smooth transition or something like that. So those are kind of ways where you can tell that you were kind of astral traveling. Or the out of body experience where you see yourself floating up on the ceiling and you look down at your body. And if you get really super, you know, fearful, you'll just jump right back into the body. Mm-hmm. If you actually can move out of it and be there, hold it, and start to realize you're in your astral form and start to work with your astral form, then you will begin to then go, you test it out, and then you start going through walls, and then maybe up on the ceiling, and then maybe up on the roof, and then you can start to go, you know, more further into other worlds and dimensions, and that's when you really get going there. But I wouldn't suggest going to that extreme until you have done some training. Mm-hmm. Astral traveling is very, very dangerous if you are not aware of all the negative entities, beings that can suck on your energy, try to keep you in a disempowered state while you're in the astral. Mm-hmm. Lots of weird creatures out there. So I just say, do it slowly. Do it where you're feeling more confident about your abilities in the astral state before you start venturing out too far. So,
you know, the first time when I was learning to astral travel, I was just learning to come out of my body. And it started out where I would just take my hand and mm-hmm. just feel it actually leave my hand, right? And then I'll never forget the first time when I was like pushing out of my body, I heard all this thunder, and it scared the hell out of me. I was like, whoop! And I jumped right back in my body again.
They call that astral wind.
Yeah.
Some people hear it as wind or this loud whooshing sound or this loud noise.
Oh man, it was like thunder and lightning. It scared the hell out of me. I was like, whoa.
It can be kind of scary and dangerous. So just make sure that you're, you know, it takes some Jedi training really to kind of go through that process to do that well, like they do in Doctor Strange. That's not something you just get up one day and just start doing.
If you haven't seen it.
Anyway, awesome. great movie.
Awesome movie.
Thank you for that question. It's a really good question.
Thank you.
And I guess we could, so what about this one?
Which one? Oh, this one's directed at me. Okay.
Well, I don't know if it was directed at you, but well, I think remember, something you said. I,
yeah, talk
this was
about
something
that.
About what we were talking about, the star people and yeah. Brad Steiger's book. And so it was relating to that.
So the question is, how can we discern or decipher which copy of Brad Steiger's The Star People will have the listings on the inside jacket? That's a very good question. That book actually was kind of kick-started a lot of things for me, because the book itself, Brad and Sherry Steiger wrote the book, and they started having all these people that were telling them about all these experiences that they had, and that's when Brad started realizing that these people were not of this earth. And so he put a compilation of all their stories in a book, which is called Star People. There's Star People 1, Star People 2. Now, if you can find an original copy, I don't even know if it's in print anymore, but if you can find an original copy of the first book, Star People, it has the questionnaire. Mm-hmm. That's what the question's about. The questionnaire is a fold-out thing that has all the characteristics mm-hmm. of what a starseed is. Different blood type, affinity with children and storms, crystals and healing, and there's like this whole list of everything. And I had the original book, and I was just learning about myself, because my family and environment that I was in, they had no clue about any of this. And I found and I checkmarked like every single one of them in there completely adhered to who I was. And at that moment, everything in my life made sense. For the first time, I felt at peace and I felt at home about those things. So that's what I would tell you, is I would tell you that the very first book, which is Star People, is one that has a questionnaire. If you can find it,
and if you can't find it,
luck.
You can also go on the internet, because there's very similar questionnaires out there about Star People. So it might even be his.
Yeah, over the years, a lot of people have kind of extended that.
Yeah, but you can find it on the internet as well. Even you might even be able to find his list. Maybe they've revised his own list.
You know, truly, Brad and his wife, Sherry, were the forebringers of what it is to be starseed. They're the ones that coined the phrase starseed. They're mm-hmm. the ones that literally brought it into the light of the world. Thank God for you guys, because I wonder if he even knows today the Mecca that he's created. You know, why we're here in this video talking to you. How many out there?
Well, yeah, we each come in around to it in our own ways. It's like there's so many people stepping forward with this now, which is great, you know, with the information. So,
and if you're watching this video, it's more than likely it's your starseed. Probably 98.99.9%. Just saying. Yeah.
So we'll take our last question that we're both going to answer, I guess. And this is going to be, I'm excited for your future videos. Thank you both. Love you. Love you too. my question is, what happens to people who don't wake up in this lifetime, or wake up this lifetime? Will they be able to reincarnate here to experience paradise with us? I heard of a kind of divide thing, and people who don't wake up leave, which got me worried, as this is pretty sad. Kind of asking because I don't know if my mother will wake up. I try my best. I know you can't force people, as they have to do it themselves, but it hurts all the same.
I think we can go to two really different angles. You know, we'll go with what you have.
It's a really big question, because it's a very important question that when you do start to awaken, right? You start to awaken on your path and really start to learn and grow and expand and start to gather all this information. Mm-hmm. And then you're all excited about it. You might be some confused about some of it too, about who you are, but you start to share it with your family members. And what happens? The family members are like, what the heck are you talking about? You're crazy. Because they may not be in the same place with this, okay? They may not have gotten where you are, and their alarm clock, if they are starseed, maybe hasn't gone off yet.
And no matter what, you cannot convince them.
You can't convince them. You can't force them. We know this, because really the best thing to do with this, because, yeah, not everybody is going to go sailing off, you know, into this, like, extreme adventure. And it's okay, because we have to honor everyone's path and everyone's journey. Everyone's soul came here to experience something specific for them. We don't know what that is. If they are still wanting to experience being asleep, then they need to experience that. It might be for some purpose, okay? Mm-hmm. So anyone who is awakening or coming into that is going to be doing it on their own way, and they're gonna be doing it in their own time. So all you can do is you can provide information for them if you get excited, but don't get knocked off your path if they are like, you're crazy, that's stupid, we don't know what you're talking about, you know, and still gonna give the 3D asleepness answers to you. You have to be able to go, okay, I totally understand where you're at. Totally appreciate that, just wanted to share it, you know, and just continue going on your path if you, you know, resonating with what you resonate mm-hmm. with. It's not about trying to, you know, make sure that they come with you. Okay, that's kind of the ego's like thing. Well, you know, I have to kind of control it, right? It's a little bit of control in there. Not saying we all do it because we all love these people too. It's out of love as well. But there's some part of this that we say each has to walk their own path. Each has their own journey. And we have to respect their journeys and where they're at. If they start asking questions and they start wanting information, then yes, let's give it to them in pieces.
Yep.
But don't overwhelm and don't overload and don't worry about their path. It's not your responsibility, mm-hmm. you know, just taking care of yourself and making sure that you're being, you know, being of an integrity, you know, to yourself, and then also allowing them to have their own experience.
Thank you for that. There's two things that come to mind. One is programming. And the other is reference point. Now, when Columbus came here and the ships were approaching the shore, the natives were right there on the shore and they were looking at the ships and they never even saw them. They were completely invisible to them, even though they're like right there. No reference point. Never seen anything like that. So they absolutely had no reference point in their mind to even know what that possibly could be. It looked like little rifts in the water, but they had no clue of what it was until it was upon them, right? So my point being with that is, if your parents or those loved ones that go through that have no reference point, and they're programmed with everything else that they've been programmed with, because believe me, it's a big program happening for a very, very long time. I call it, let's call it sins of the father, okay? So there's no reference book for, you know, back then raising a child. So what do people do? Well, I turned out okay. I think I'll raise my kid the way my parents raised me, which was wrong usually because it's from out of dysfunction. So there begins the programming. Then you're taught that anything outside of the norm is, how many times you heard throughout history, heresy. You don't believe the way I believe, so you're a heretic. Sound familiar? The Salem witch hunt, remember that? All started because some clergy wanted to get together with some little hot thing and she denied him. So out of revenge, accused her of being a witch. And the next thing you know, it was like the big tidal wave that just went and swept across the land. Again, programming. So the bottom line, folks, is it's not an easy plight wakening up to the fact that you're not from this place. It's not easy sometimes losing friends and loved ones because you're so definitive and secular in your own thoughts and understanding of who you are that they would never even have a clue, could never even come to understand. And there always comes a point. And I tell this to all my starborn out there, whether it be your mom, dad, brothers, sisters, uncles, boss, whoever it may be, if it comes to the point you're vexatious to my spirit, I'm sorry, I love you, and I release you. It comes to the point where they're never gonna get it, but that's okay, because like Lightstar said, they're on their own path. You're on your own path. They can't walk your path, you can't walk their path. Their path is their path.
And you might even say, it's not that they may never get it, because actually they might get it, but eventually. It isn't your job to make them get it. you know what I'm saying? Like, they have a time and a place that maybe 10 years down the road, you know, they have a big awakening or something happens to them and it awakens. Well, then that was their time.
We shall serve no wine before its time.
Yeah, you just have to let that kind of go.
We have found starseed that have awoken when they were like, it happened to me when I was three years old. That's when the awakening happened with me. And I already, you know, I can't tell you how many arguments I got in with my mother about, you know, you sure I wasn't adopted? He's like, by God, I was in the operating room 20 hours with you. And okay, I'm sorry.
I used to say the same kind of thing, but I'd say, was it the milkman theory? I kind
of
have
the milkman theory.
I don't
get a lot of that.
Something.
The milkman theory, seriously.
There's a lot of us that feel that way. We understand that you feel that way because we all get it and we all can understand that. But just know that you're the parents that you chose. Yes, you chose
to come to those
parents for reasons where you needed to learn some lessons. Maybe you need to actually have more confidence within yourself. So you're going to have parents that are going to constantly be making you feel insecure about yourself until you finally get to the point where you say, I'm going to be confident in what I'm saying, what I'm feeling, no matter what anybody else. So we choose these kind of things to happen. That's why we can't really give any of our judgments to the family members, because we did choose this. We did choose the experiences and everybody's getting something out of it. So just don't worry about the parents that you may have to let that go, or you may have to release it, or you may have to distance yourself from it. It's okay.
Absolutely.
You're doing what you need to do for your soul and they're doing what they need to do for their soul.
So here's some homework for you. Look back on your parentage, the way you were raised, and then reflect upon that and see what lessons you chose for yourself in that situation. And you will find, I promise you, that it was a catalyst to propel you into who you are today.
Yep. You know that saying, no pain, no gain? Well, that's kind of relates to families and how we also choose this. Sometimes it's not, and we don't always have to live, you know, learn through pain. I'm just saying in the way that we, a lot of us have chosen to kind of have that experience is to be the defining moment sometimes is because of your terrible childhood, you know, or where you stood up for, you know, you stood up because now you're going to break the chain from your family's alcoholism and you're going to start breaking the chain and now you're going to help other people that have the same problem. Well, then you look at it and you say, it's a blessing that I went through that.
So look at it as, you know, like some of them are not going to get to go where we're going or anything like that. Okay. If I was to tell you, all right, just a possible scenario, that everybody talks about this utopic society that they want to create, right? What if that society that we're creating isn't for us? Never was. What if we are the forebringers of that new world that in a far-off future will be one of sustainability, no more hatred, no more racism, no more violence or wars or, God help us all, no more politics? Right? Think about that. Think about how much that would change your life, knowing that you're not creating this for yourself. You're creating it for the future selves and the future world and for your children's children.
Yeah, because in our linear time here on Earth, time doesn't exist, but we have this linear time that we see this timeline and say how long things actually take to happen here. May not be in your lifetime, you know, that everything's going to be all pristine and clear and like perfect and all of that. It's like, it may not, but it doesn't matter. It's just that the fact is that we are here to do what we came here to do, what we signed up to do, and honoring that.
I'm right there with a lot of you. Okay. We thought it was a vacation.
Yeah.
Somebody lied.
Somebody lied.
No, not a vacation.
Don't want to go there. Okay. Yeah. I guess I have to. Yeah. Now we're here. But anyways, so we hope we have answered all of these questions. So you know, this is all coming from our perspective. This is all from us. We're not saying that this is the answer to everything. We're not saying this is the right answer to everything. We're saying this is our perspectives on how we see things based on obviously our experiences or what we've seen and other people's experiences.
We're just a couple schmoes sharing with you.
Just sharing. Yeah. Just sharing the love.
Sharing the love.
So anyway, thank you guys for all the questions. If you would like to
keep
work,
them coming.
If you would like to work with us anymore, if further with session work, we have a couple sessions on our StarseedAllianceInternational.com website. Mm-hmm. You can go to our session page. We have a ACT session, an Activational Co-Creative Therapy session that we do together. And we also have a Harmonic Resonance Therapy session, or Harmonic Resonance Healing session.
Healing session.
That can be in person or in actually remote, wherever you are in the world. Mm-hmm. So a lot, and same with the ACT session actually, but we can actually do these things you know, usually by Skype and by phone, if you're in the US, so, or in person, but you can check those out. And we also have, my website is lightstarcreations.com, and you can check out, I do a lot of session work with Starseed, as well as teaching sessions. Mm-hmm. I have my artwork that is activational, and you can purchase my artwork on my website. And lots of other goodies on there, so you can go check that out. And then his website.
And my website is standswithbear.com. And you'll find there that on some of the techniques I do is holographic DNA restructurization, which was taught to me by my star family. I didn't learn it here or from any books or any of that. Pretty much everything I do. And also I have my music CDs, because I play native flute professionally, and I have several CDs out. And so lots of good stuff in that page. And, you know,
lots of good stuff there. Yeah,
lots of good stuff right there. And if you like it, and I know you will, then please share the love. You know, if you need a session, anything we can do, we're here.
Yeah, we're here for you guys. We love you guys. Everything we do, you know, that we put together is to help you guys in your further spiritual progression and your journey forth in the awakening process.
We want to be the people for you that we never had when we had to go through all this. Yeah. So we want to be there for you to help you and assist you and go, come with me if you want to live. Not really.
Well, thanks for watching, you guys. We appreciate it. And if you'd like to subscribe to our channel, you can do so as well on our YouTube channel if you're not already there. But you can go to the YouTube Starseed Alliance and subscribe to our channel. All right. That is all for now. Signing off. Blessings.
Blessings.
To you all.
Namaste.
Love you.
Love you.
Bye.